Hello everyone, today we will introduce two more concepts, value at risk and expected shortfall. Value at risk is a very widely used concept, so it's very important that you understand at least the basics of it. We have seen in the Greek letters that people want to summarize state of a portfolio or health of a portfolio by a few key numbers, and hence the concept of Greek letters came in picture. So there are five numbers which could tell you many things about the state of the portfolio. Okay. But some people felt that even talking about five different numbers was difficult. So can we have a single number which can summarize the state of a portfolio? That's where this concept of VAR, value at risk, came into picture. So it's a single number which can tell us something about the portfolio. In fact, which can tell us many important things about the portfolio. So, what does VAR mean? So, generally, when using VAR, an analyst is interested in making statement of the form, I'm X percent certain that there will not be a loss of more than V rupees in the next N days. So, for example, I want to say that I am 95% confident that whatever loss we will have in the next week, it would not be beyond 1 lakh. So, if you want to make statement of that type, then you have to calculate VAR. And this V is actually VAR, value at risk. So when I said 1 lakh, this 1 lakh is VAR. Okay. And it is known as X percent N day VAR. So V is X percent N day VAR. Okay. So if you change N or if you change X, of course this is going to change. Okay. So, X is the confidence level, so how confident you are and for how much time interval you are talking about, so that is N days. So, the maximum loss that you will suffer in these N days, and you are saying this with X percent confidence, okay. So, as statistics students, you should be able to see what this means in terms of probability distribution. Okay, let me draw a picture. So, losses are generally denoted by negative numbers and profits are generally denoted by positive numbers. So, let us say this is the graph of PDF of change in portfolio worth. Okay, suppose this is graph of PDF of change in portfolio worth. So, change in portfolio worth could be positive, negative. Let us say this is zero, suppose. It doesn't have to be normal, okay? Just because, you know, we are used to drawing bell-shaped curve, I drew a bell-shaped, roughly bell-shaped curve, but it doesn't have to be normal. So, losses would be somewhere here, okay? Losses would be somewhere here. And we are saying that V is a value which says that you won't have a loss greater than V with X percent confidence. So, V is going to be some value here. Loss greater than V would mean this. And we are saying that we are confident with X percent. So, X percent confidence means what? That there is only 100 minus X percent chance that the loss would be greater than V. Okay. So, probability of this interval, so probability of this region becomes 100 minus X percent means you will say by 100. Okay. If I want to write in terms of probability. Correct? So, what is V now? Statistically, what is V? Probabilistically, what is V? V is simply 100 minus X percentile of PDF of delta pi. If delta pi is change in portfolio worth. Okay. Of course, change in portfolio worth over a period of N days. Because as N changes, the distribution would change. So, this is distribution for this particular N. Okay. So 100 minus x percentile of PDF of delta pi over a period of n days. So this PDF is, this change over n days, we are taking PDF of this quantity. Okay? If you change n, the distribution might change. In fact, it will change. Okay? So basically, value at r is just a percentile. So when you learned percentiles in BSc first year, you probably may not have realized that it is such an important concept. So value at risk is a very, very, very important concept in finance, and it is nothing but a percentile value. Okay. Of course, when you try to, summarize a big thing by a single number, it is going to leave some loopholes. So some people do have some objections to VAR. So what are those objections? So I drew one graph, fine. Okay, so let me draw it again for comparison purpose. So this is one graph. Suppose it has V here. Okay, and it goes on decreasing here. Okay, the curve is supposed decreasing in this direction, tapering off. And now let me draw another graph. So suppose you have some other distribution, some other PDF where graph is something like this. Maybe something like this. Okay. And it is quite possible that both have this same V. Means, let us say we are talking about 99% VAR. So if we are talking about 99% VAR, it is quite possible that both these distribution have same 99th percentile, that is V. So technically, both of them would have same VAR, and you would be tempted to conclude that both the portfolios are equally risky. However, when you look at the actual graph of the distribution, you can see here that in this, the distribution with blue curve, things were tapering off. So the chances of higher and higher loss, they were going on decreasing. Whereas in this black curve, you have a small peak here. Okay. You have a small black peak over here. As a result, chances of this loss are less. Chances of loss near V are less. But chances of higher loss are more. So ideally, this portfolio should be considered as more risky, because if you are in the unfortunate 1% scenario, chances of loss are okay, but the expected amount of loss would be higher, because higher loss has higher proportion. Okay, these loss values have lower chances, but these loss values have higher chances of occurring. So you are more likely to lose more money. Okay, hence people said that VAR is not a very perfect measure, and you should go for something called as expected shortfall. Okay, so what is an expected shortfall? So expected shortfall is conditional expectation, basically. Okay, so let me write down the definition of expected shortfall. It is expected loss during an n day period. Expected loss during an n day period conditional on conditioned on the portfolio change being conditioned on the portfolio change being in the left 100 minus x percent tail region of the distribution. Okay, so maybe I don't know if you have followed what I'm trying to say. So it's a conditional distribution, given that the portfolio change is already in this tail region. So maybe writing notations would be easier. So it is expectation of delta pi, given that delta pi is already less than V. Okay, so this is a conditional expectation. See, notations make things simpler, not complicated. Okay, so expected shortfall is this conditional expectation, because here in the black curve, expected shortfall will be high. When I say high, or when I say value at risk is V, I'm talking about their magnitudes. Okay, so high means magnitude wise it would be high, because loss would be high, because it's loss, it is negative, but magnitude wise it would be high. And value at risk also, ideally this V would be negative, but while reporting it is reported as positive, because we say we are going to lose this much rupees. So ideally it would be mod V. Okay, fine. So we have expected shortfall here and var. Now, as you can see, yes, expected shortfall does remove one drawback of var, but still var is much more popular than expected shortfall. Okay, maybe because it is more appealing to have such sentence, you know, I am X percent confident that my loss will not exceed such and such number. And computationally also, mathematically also, if someone wants to write, percentiles are much easier to understand than say conditional expectation. So whatever may be reasons, but var is more popular. So we will study var in more detail. But I wanted you to know that var is not a flawless concept, even though it is widely used, and there is some alternative, which is expected shortfall. Okay, now few basics about var. First of all, we said that we talk about end day var. So end day var, talking about end day var is generally difficult, because all our calculations are happening on daily basis. So it is easy to calculate one day var and then approximate it. So one day var into root n is generally taken as end day var. So what is the basis of this? Can you guess? If you have a normal distribution, then this could be easily seen. So suppose daily portfolio changes have IID normal distribution. Okay, and let us say delta pi for ith day has normal distribution with mean 0 and some variance sigma square. Because they are IID, we won't have I in sigma square. Mean 0, generally mean of portfolio changes is taken as 0 while calculating var. Ideally, I mean, if you try to estimate the mean, it may not be exactly equal to 0, it would be close to 0. But the variance is so higher than mean that for practical purposes, you could very well take it at 0, and hence it is customary to take mean of portfolio changes as 0 over any day and hence over any interval. Okay. So total portfolio change in the portfolio worth over a period of n day would be sum over delta pi. Okay. I going from 1 to capital N. So distribution of this would be normal with mean 0, and what would be the variance? So it would be addition of all these variances, because they are independent, covariance won't come into picture. So it would be n times sigma square. Okay. And now what can we say about the percentiles? So when you want to compute say 99th percentile of this first distribution, let me call this as say C1, change 1, and let me call this as say C2. Okay, C1 is daily change, C2 is change over n day interval. Okay, so C1 has normal distribution with mean 0 and variance sigma square, and we want to compute var for that, which would be say V1, and C2 has normal distribution with mean 0, variance n sigma square, and var for that let me denote by V2. So V2 and V1 are such that probability of C1 less than or equal to V1 is say 99%, or we can write X percent, no doubt. Okay, so we want something like this. So this would mean probability of C1 by sigma is less than or equal to V1 by sigma is equal to X percent. Okay, this is the routine adjustment that we do in normal, and C1 by sigma is your standard normal. So probability of z less than or equal to v1 by sigma is x percent. Okay, so this is what? So v1 is sigma times z x. Okay, so xth percentile of standard normal distribution. Okay, so this is xth percentile of standard normal distribution. So v1 is sigma times that. Okay, now if I try to do same thing for c2, what happens? Probability of c2 less than v2, we want to be x percent. But now for c2, variance is n sigma square. So root n sigma should be less than v2 by root n sigma. This should be x percent. So again, probability of z, because c2 by root n sigma becomes z. Z less than v2 by root n sigma is x percent. So v2 is root n sigma zx. Okay. So v2 is root n times v1. Okay. Hence, n day var is root n times 1 day var. So for normal distribution, this relationship is perfectly true. But for non-normal distribution, it need not be true. However, for the sake of convenience and simplicity, it is taken as approximation for n day var. Okay. Okay. So this is the basic concept of var. Now we have to talk about how to estimate var. Okay. Given any portfolio, how do you estimate value of at risk? So there are two approaches. One is known as historical simulation approach, and other is known as model building approach. So first, let me introduce historical simulation approach. Okay. So what is historical simulation approach? So suppose we want to calculate 1-day var. So as we discussed, we would always calculate 1-day var. So suppose I want to calculate 1-day var, and I am planning to use data from past 500 days for that. Okay. So I have data from past 500 days of the market, and we are going to use that data for calculating 1-day var. Okay. So how do we do that? So let us assume that our portfolio has not changed over a period of 500 days. So all the instruments that we have are same. So there are multiple factors that are going to affect my portfolio worth. So say stock price of one company, stock price of other company, and so on. Suppose we have, say, stock prices of n companies, and then we have different number of shares. So say N1, S1, N2, S2, NN, SN. Okay. So my portfolio consists of N1 shares for one company, N2 shares for other company, and so on. And these are the stock prices. And I have day 1, day 2 up to day 500. Okay. Day 1, day 2 up to day 500. And we generally start with day 0 as current day. So let me take day 0. And then this day 500 is my current day. Okay. Day 500 is my current day. So I have to estimate 1-day var for today, means for tomorrow, what will be the distribution of my portfolio change. So how will I use this historical data? Suppose there are some values here. So suppose this is, say, 20.33. This is, say, 0.1132. Of course, these numbers are in, say, thousands. And this is, suppose, say, 65.37. Then on day 1, these were day 0 values. On day 1, these values became, say, 20.78, then 0.1159, and 64.91, etc. Okay. And on day 500, suppose I have 25.85, 0.1343, and 62.10, etc. on every day using these values, we can compute portfolio worth. So pi naught, pi 1, pi 2, these are portfolio worth on respective days. So pi 500. And using these portfolio worths, we can compute delta pi also. Okay? But right now, we won't compute that delta pi. In fact, that would probably be another approach. I'll discuss shortly. Okay, so the usual historical simulation approach, what does it tell us? So now, see, I have many possibilities of one day change. So day 0 to day 1 was one day change. Day 1 to day 2 was one day change. Day 3, 2 to day 3 was one day change and so on. And I have so many variables involved. So what I can do is, first, let us see what the data tells me using just day 0 and day 1. So the first market variable, so this is first market variable, this is second market variable, this is nth market variable. So for the first market variable, the change is 20.78 divided by 20.33. Correct. For the second market variable, change is 0.1159 upon 0.1132. For the third market variable, it is 64.91 upon 65.37. So these are possible change values for these market variables. And now we simulate the scenarios, simulate all possible scenarios, all possible needs, simulate many possible scenarios. So because my current value is 25.85, my first simulation says, okay, this 25.85 can change at this rate and it would become 25.85 into this ratio, 20.78 divided by 20.33. Does it intuitively make sense? So this was a relative change and this could possibly occur as change today also. If it occurs today, then value would become this into that change. Similarly, 0.1343 into 0.1159 by 0.1132, then 62.10 into 64.91 upon 65.37. Okay, so this way we calculate first simulation. Then we can use day 1 and day 2 data in a similar manner to get second simulation. Okay, so whatever are day 2 values, let me write some values. So suppose on day 2 we have 21.44, 0.1162 and let us say 65.02. Then by taking this ratio, 21.44 upon 20.78, into this, I will get second simulation, 0.1162 divided by 0.1159 into this, and then 65.02 divided by 64.91 into this. Okay, so this will give me another possible simulation. Okay, and in this way, using the data, so day 1 gave me simulation 1, using day 1 and 2, so day 1 to 2 gives me simulation 2. Day 2 to 3 will give me simulation 3, and in this way, day 499 to day 500 will give me simulation 500. Okay, and now corresponding to each of these changes, I will get the corresponding value of delta pi. Possible changes now, delta pi 1, delta pi 2 up to delta pi 500. Okay, so this is like a sample. Okay, so this is like a sample coming from distribution of portfolio changes. Okay, and now I can estimate 100 minus x percentile of these values. Okay, so this is a sample. So to estimate percentile, we know we can estimate sample percentiles. So we can estimate 100 minus sample percentile from this sample. And that would become my one day var for this particular portfolio. Okay, that becomes my one day var for this particular portfolio. One advantage of this historical simulation method is we are not requiring any distributional assumption. We are deriving the distribution purely on the basis of observed historical data. So it's kind of a non-parametric method. Okay, and even though it is non-parametric method, it does take care of correlations between the market variables also. because we are never using the market variables independently. We are using entire data for one day. So when we use entire data for one day, these values are correlated with each other, but we are not destroying that relationship because we are using them together, that correlation is captured. Okay, so even though the joint distribution of individual market variables might be complicated, we are trying to model it via a very, very, very simple simulation approach. Okay, so that's why historical simulation is a very preferred method, because it's easy to, mathematically it doesn't require any assumptions. Of course, it does require some computationally intense things, but otherwise it's a very elegant approach, I would say. Okay, the second approach that people have been using for estimating VAR is known as model building approach. So what's a model building approach? Here we assume normal distribution. Okay, so we can, if we are talking about single stock, then we assume univariate normal distribution. If we talk about multiple stocks, then we have to talk about multivariate normal distribution. So let me talk about single asset case first. Okay, so suppose we have a portfolio which consists of a position in single stock. Okay, so we have a portfolio which consists of position in a single stock, and let us say that single stock is, say, Microsoft. So we have a portfolio with $10 million in shares of Microsoft. So the current portfolio worth is $10 million. Okay, and let us assume that volatility of Microsoft is 2% per day. Volatility of position in Microsoft is 2% per day. Okay, so because of this volatility, and so 2% means whatever you have invested in Microsoft, 2% of that. So in our case, it is $10 million. I hope everyone knows 1 million is equivalent to 10 lakhs. So 10 million, 2% of 10 million would become 2 lakh. Okay. So volatility is $2 lakh. And as I had mentioned earlier, it is customary to take mean return at zero. Okay, because mean return is more or less close to zero, and especially when compared to variance, it's very close to zero. So it is customary to take it at zero. So now we are saying that the change in the portfolio worth here has normal distribution with mean zero and variance 2 lakh square. Okay, because volatility is just sigma. So variance 2 lakh square. Okay, and we have derived earlier the formula. So this would be, let me go back. So when we were discussing relationship between one day VAR and n day VAR, we did describe this. Okay, so if you have 0 and sigma, then the value at risk becomes sigma into corresponding percentile of normal distribution. Okay, we did derive this. Corresponding percentile of standard normal. So if I want to talk about 99% VAR, then we have to take first percentile of standard normal. So that is 2.33, minus 2.33, but we'll take positive because we are already calling it loss. So 2.33 into sigma. Okay, so 2.33 into 2 lakh means my one day VAR becomes this. So this means $4,66,000. Okay, my one day VAR becomes this, and of course from this we can calculate root n into 4,66,000 as n day VAR. Okay, generally people compute 10 day VAR, Okay, 10-day VAR is generally quite widely used. So this is how you deal with a single asset via model building approach. Okay, so it is again very easy to understand. It just involves percentile of normal distribution. Okay. Now, second thing is we can have now two asset case. Okay. So, two asset case. Suppose you have a position in Microsoft. So, $10 million shares in Microsoft. And in addition to that, suppose we have $5 million shares in AT&T. Okay. So, now we have a portfolio which consists of shares of two types, not just one type. Okay. And we have to talk about VAR of this portfolio. So, here we'll have to talk about bivariate normal distribution. So, suppose correlation between these is 0.3. Okay. So, correlation between returns on Microsoft and returns on AT&T is suppose 0.3. For Microsoft, we have already said that sigma would be 2 lakh. We are continuing with the same data. And for AT&T, suppose this sigma is given to be, daily volatility is given to be 1%. Okay, for AT&T it is 1% and you have 5 million. So, 1% of 5 million becomes 50,000. So, sigma for AT&T is suppose 50,000. Okay, so now we have to calculate sigma of M plus A, because in my portfolio I have both these things. So variance of the addition, variance of the total portfolio worth would be sigma of M plus A. So we know it will be sigma M square plus sigma A square plus 2 rho sigma M sigma A. Correct? This is our usual formula. So, if you substitute the values, this turns out to be 220,227. Okay. And now, so this is the joint volatility for the portfolio, combined volatility for the portfolio, aggregate volatility. So, now, my value at risk for the entire portfolio would be 2.33 into 220,227. So this value turns out to be $513,129. Okay. So this is aggregate VAR. Now we had already calculated individual VAR for Microsoft. Homework is calculate individual VAR for AT&T. I will write down the final answer here. So for AT&T, individual VAR turns out to be, again we are talking about single day VAR, so it turns out to be 116,500, 99% single day VAR. And you can see here that if you add the individual VARs, what you get is larger than this joint VAR. Okay, so aggregated VAR is actually less than individual VAR for Microsoft plus individual VAR for AT&T. Why? So this is the benefit of diversification. Because we have two types of shares, our losses are at least up to some extent getting compensated. Hence, aggregated VAR here is less. So the joint portfolio is less risky than these two independent portfolios if they are added together. Okay. In fact, you can verify that if correlation is perfect, then these two sides of the inequality match. Okay. So if correlation is perfect, one, then these two would match. But if correlation is away from one, if it's negative, it would be further less. Aggregated VAR would be further less. But even in a positive correlation scenario, some losses get compensated and your aggregated VAR is less than the addition of individual VARs. And hence, diversification of a portfolio is always a necessity. Okay. So this is a model building approach for two asset case. We can then generalize to multiple asset case. So let me quickly write down the general equation. So this is known as linear model approach. Okay. So linear model approach. So portfolio consists of say n assets, okay, with amounts alpha I being invested in ith asset. Okay, amount alpha I being invested in ith asset. So the let delta xi be return, daily return on ith asset. Then delta p would be sum over alpha I delta xi. Okay, delta p would be sum over alpha I delta xi. So how can we talk about now the portfolio where? So for that we have to talk about volatility of the entire portfolio, correct? So we will define sigma square p as sum over I going from 1 to n, sum over j going from 1 to n, rho ij, correlation between ith returns on ith and jth asset, alpha I, alpha j, sigma I, sigma j. Correct? So I'm allowing I equal to j. So in I equal to j case, you would have sigma I square, sigma j square, so the variances. Okay. And once you have this, then 2.33 into this sigma, sigma p, would give you var for the entire portfolio. Okay. So var for the portfolio would be 2.33 into sigma p, where sigma p is calculated by this form. So whatever we did for two asset case, we are now generalizing to n asset case. That's all. Okay. So these are some of the approaches for calculating value at risk. As I mentioned, value at risk is a very important measure, but it does have some drawback, which is addressed by expected shortfall. So you should know both these concepts, and the methods for computation are also quite easy. Okay, so let me stop here. Thank you.